introduction. My name is Soma, and today I'm going to talk to you about the standard model of particle physics, which will hopefully give you a better insight into how the universe works, so I can get high expectations. I've learned about this topic when I spent my summer at the European Organization for Nuclear Research, also known as CERN. During my time there, I was lucky enough to get to know a physicist by the name of Frederick, and although there are many interesting stories about them, today I only want to tell you one. After graduating from high school, he didn't start studying physics, as it would sound logical. Instead of that, he started studying philosophy, and later he changed to physics. Now this might sound unfamiliar if you read it for the first time, so let's have a closer look at these two disciplines. What do philosophers do? Well, they ask the most fundamental questions of mankind, don't they? Like, who are we? Where do we come from? And where are we going? And what do physicists do? Here is a picture of the history of the universe, starting with the Big Bang. And here are the questions that physicists ask regarding it. What happened at the Big Bang? What is our universe made of? And what will happen to it in the future? Now, you might notice that there's a similarity between philosophers and physicists. And we have to admit that this connection was even stronger in the past, since one of the first people who addressed these deeply scientific questions was an ancient Greek philosopher by the name of Democritus. His theory said that if you took any object and you divided it, and you did it again and again and again, that at some point you would reach the smallest, undividable, ultimate building blocks of everything. Although he came up with this theory thousands of years ago, he had a huge influence on the future of science, since atoms turned out to be a real thing, although J.J. Thomson discovered the electrons, which means that atoms were not elementary at all. Later, Rutherford and his Boltzmann experiment stated that the atoms had a positively charged nucleus surrounded by negatively charged electrons. And as time went on, scientists contributed to the model, and this one was born. We all know it from basic science class, and it shows the positively charged protons in the nucleus with the neutral neutrons surrounded by negatively charged electrons. It seems like a complete model that describes everything, and everything is fine. The only problem with it is that it's not complete at all. Because in the 20th century, physicists discovered literally hundreds of new particles, and these discoveries became so often that Robert Oppenheimer, the founder of the nuclear bomb, once said that the following year's Nobel Prize will be awarded to the physicist who does not discover a new particle. And, I mean, we like discoveries, don't we? Well, we do, but the interesting thing about these particles was that none of them was explained by protons, neutrons, and electrons. So it became clear that a new theory was needed. A new theory that explained both the new particles and that remained consistent with the atomic theory. This new model is called the standard model of particle physics. And although it's a mathematical formulation, I promise you that today we won't discuss any single line of equations. So what is the standard model? Well, it is our most up-to-date theory of particle physics, and it describes everything from a really tiny scale to a huge one. It explains why giant stars burn, and it explains what holds a tiny nucleus together. The standard model describes every fundamental elementary particle that we have observed so far. By elementary, I mean that they don't have other smaller particles inside of them. They are undividable. They are the smallest, ultimate building blocks of the universe, and everything is built of them. And I mean, this would be a fantastic thing in itself, but the standard model offers you even more, because it also describes the different forces that govern the behavior of these particles. It might sound a little bit strange that I've mentioned forces, but you can see further particles. I promise you that we'll come back to this in a minute, but first let's have a look at the structure of the model. On the left-hand side, you can see the metal particles. Everything is built out of them. One kind of these metal particles are called quarks. There's six of them by the name of up, down, charm, strange, top, and bottom. But you will never encounter a lonely bottom quark, because quarks always join each other to form composite particles, so they never exist alone. Such a composite particle is the proton, which has two up quarks and one down quark. Similarly, the neutron has two down quarks and one up quark. And what you can see here is an atomic nucleus, and you only use up and down quarks. If you add the electron, you can literally explain everything that you can see around yourselves right now, only using these three fundamental particles. You are made of them, I'm made of them, and even the galaxies billions of light years away from us are made of the exact same three particles. And this is fantastic. So what you have to remember about quarks is that they always form composite particles. In contrast to them, the other kind of elementary particles are called leptons. And we know of six of them. Three of the leptons are charged, and the most famous one is the electron, which we know from basic science class. But a pretty common one is the muon, which you can find in different particle decays. And right now, in this minute, thousands of muons are rushing through this room right now, also through you, because they are also produced when high energy particles from deep space hit the atmosphere. The third charged lepton is called the tau particle, and it's even more massive, because the electron is the lightest, the muon is about 200 times heavier, and the tau is about 3,000 times heavier than the electron. Now, every charged lepton is an associated neutral particle, which are called the electron neutrino, the muon neutrino, and the tau neutrino. The basic difference between them is that electron neutrinos are always produced in association with electrons, muon neutrinos with muons, and tau neutrinos with tau particles. And there are three tricky things about neutrinos. They are massless, but they have really, really little mass. They are electrically neutral, and they rarely interact with ordinary matter. This means that if you wanted to stop only half of the neutrinos coming from the sun, you would have to put several light years of solid lead in their way to make only half of them interact with it. This also means that it's hard to detect them in your detectors because they don't interact with the detector either. So what physicists do is that when they see that some energy is missing from the interaction, they conclude that a neutrino had to be involved. And yeah, that's it about quarks and leptons. We have talked about the basic fundamental building blocks of the universe, but we haven't mentioned the forces that govern them. We haven't mentioned the forces that govern the behavior of these particles, that govern the behavior of the universe, and that make life possible. But fortunately, the standard model does this for us. We know of four fundamental forces. Gravity is one of them, and we all know it because that's what keeps us attached to Earth. We are also familiar with electromagnetism, and it's responsible for, well, really surprisingly, for electricity and magnetism. And on the atomic scale, one of its responsibilities is to keep the electrons around the positively discharged nucleus. But the story starts getting more interesting now, because most of us have probably not learned about the strong and the weak nuclear forces. The reason for that might be that they have a really, really tiny range, which is smaller than the size of a single proton. Nevertheless, they play a really important role in our everyday lives, because the strong force is the one which keeps the protons and neutrons stick to each other, just like the quarks. And the weak nuclear force is a special one, but it's responsible for nuclear weak, but also for nuclear reactions. But most of the example that we know from everyday life is radioactive decay, and it's caused by the weak nuclear force. Today, we won't discuss gravity, because it's simply not part of the standard model, but we will discuss the electromagnetic force and the strong nuclear force. But before we get into any details about them, let's clarify this, because in the past few minutes, I've been talking about forces, but you can only see further particles on the slide. The reason for that is that on the quantum scale, you have to imagine an interaction between two particles as an exchange of an interaction particle. To clarify this, let's have an example that we all know. It's the electromagnetic force. And we all know that if we approach two magnets and the same poles are pointing towards each other, they will repel. Just like that, the same charges repel each other. So if you have these two electrons and they approach each other, you know that they will repel. The reason for this repulsion is an electromagnetic interaction, and since the interaction particle for the electromagnetic force is a photon, the repulsion happens by exchanging a photon. The same thing is shown in this animation. You can see the two blue particles, which are two electrons, they approach each other, and then when they get close enough, the one emits a photon, the other one absorbs it, and that's how the whole repulsion happens. Now, it's really important to mention that this has nothing to do with Newtonian physics and action and reaction, but this is a nice analogy, and it's valid for every fundamental force that's described by this standard model. And this was electromagnetism, but unfortunately, it doesn't explain everything, because we also need the other forces. An example for that is the atomic nucleus. We've mentioned that it consists of positively charged protons and neutral neutrons, but if electromagnetism was the only force in the game, it would simply fall apart because of the electromagnetic repulsion between the positively charged protons. So it's clear that another force has to be involved. And this other force is the strong nuclear force. To understand how it works, we have to have a closer look at the proton. We said that it consisted of three different quarks, and they are held together by the strong force. Since this strong force sort of glues these particles together, the interaction particle for it is very creatively named the gluon. The same goes for the neutron, and the interesting part comes now. Because if you manage to put a proton and a neutron close enough to each other, these gluons will jump from one particle to the other, and this means that these two particles will also be connected by the strong force. And this is why an atomic nucleus can exist and why we can exist. So we've discussed the electromagnetic force with its interaction particle being the photon. We've discussed the strong force with its interaction particle being the gluon. And we've said that gravity is not part of the standard model. Although to be more precise, there's a hypothetical particle predicted by the name of graviton, but we haven't been able to observe it in our accelerators. And actually, if we wanted to observe it in a collision that happened in an accelerator, the accelerator needed to be about the size of the Milky Way, so this won't happen in the close future. And this points out a really important thing about this standard model, which is that it does not explain everything. It explains a lot, but not everything. Let me show you how everything looks like. This is everything. This is the universe surrounding us, and we are a tiny little part. And now let me show you the part of it that we understand. It's only 5% that's explained by ordinary matter and antimatter, as the standard model explains it. The rest is probably dark matter and dark energy, but we haven't observed those particles in well directly. So let's recap what we've talked about. The standard model is a mathematical formulation, so its baselines are different fields, equations, and probabilities, but these analogies are pretty good, and we've discussed this. The quarks make up composite particles like the proton and the neutron. Leptons, like the electron, don't make composite particles, they can also exist alone. And we've also discussed the fundamental forces. We know there are four fundamental forces, and three of them are covered by the standard model. These are the strong force, the electromagnetic force, and the weak force. And you have to imagine an interaction as an exchange of an interaction particle. And you can sort of see those interaction particles right here. We haven't talked about the Higgs boson, although it's a really important topic, so I'm looking forward to your questions about it. And the last thing that we mentioned about the standard model is that it's a really nice theory. It does not only explain what we have observed in the past, it also makes successful predictions regarding the future. But it's not a theory for everything. So there's lots of mysteries out there waiting for being discovered. And if you would ever wonder why physicists would come up with such crazy and mind-blowing theories like this, let me close my presentation with a quote by Richard Feynman, who was not only a Nobel Prize-winning outstanding physicist, but also a great science communicator, and he once said, "Physics is like sex. Sure, it may give practical results, but that's not why we do it." Thank you for your time.
It was really great talk. thanks for the questions. So please raise your hand if you have a question. Please.
Regarding the intellectual property of the chair, you said they release a photon, right? A is the photon, B is the reason they reject each other, and B, does it matter which electron releases the photon?
Could you repeat the first part of the question?
Okay.
Could you speak also a little bit louder?
Yes, I'm sorry. You said that when two electrons engage a magnetic force, when they meet each other, they repel, the repulsion is because of the photon being discharged.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Is the photon the reason that they are repelling each other? And is there a dominant electron?
I see your question. The photon is sort of representing the electromagnetic interaction, because what I haven't mentioned is that the whole thing happens by different fields. And the reason for the electromagnetic repulsion is the electromagnetic field. And the electromagnetic field has a smallest, we say that it's a quantum, but this means that it has a smallest possible amount or package of energy, and this smallest package of energy is the photon. So the analogy of exchanging a particle means that they exchange that smallest amount of energy.
So, any other questions? Please.
Is there such a notion as the lifespan of a particle? In other words, are they born, do they die? And if yes, then how does it happen? Thank you.
Absolutely. You remember, I can show you the quarks. The up and the down quark are stable particles, which means that they are born and they live for a really long time. But the remaining four quarks, and I haven't mentioned that, the charm, the strange, the top, and the bottom quarks are heavier quarks, and they are unstable, which means that they only live for, well, for 10 to the minus 20 something seconds. So for a really short time. And then they decay into stable particles, like the up quark and the down quark. And this decay happens by the weak interaction. But by decay, I don't mean that the, for example, the bottom quark contains an up quark, because it didn't. It's an elementary particle. You have to imagine this decay as the particle just changing its identity. So when an unstable particle decays, it changes its identity and it becomes a stable one.
So we have time for one more question. Please.
Hi. Well, here in physics, of course, claims that quarks or electrons are elementary structure in the Bible. I was wondering, how sure are science about, or put in other words, what is the experimental way to prove that particles are elementary?
All right. This is a very good question. And I mean, if we knew what we were doing, then we wouldn't call it research, would we? But thus far, every science shows that quarks and these particles are elementary. But of course, there's a lot that we don't know about this model. We don't know why there's three different groups of quarks. We also call them generations. We don't know why it's exactly three. And it's not true that it's exactly three. It might be that in the future we will discover further particles, and we hope so. But so far, every sign shows that these are elementary particles. Or, yeah, actually the elementary thing about them is not the particle, but the field that's the other kind of physical
phenomenon. This is to the best of our knowledge. So,
exactly.
So thank you very much, everyone.